Glucose is a major fuel for the tissues, so tissues constantly uptake glucose from the blood. And in normal condition, normal blood glucose level is maintained by a dietary income of glucose. But during starvation, there is no dietary glucose income into the blood. But tissues constantly uptake glucose from the blood. And in such condition, glucose level decrease. And the organism has to maintain normal blood glucose level. Without dietary income of carbohydrates, organism has to waste its own glucose reserves. And the organ that is responsible for maintenance of normal blood glucose level is liver. The concept is that decreasing glucose level in the blood induces secretion of glucagon that activates glycogenolysis and induces gluconeogenesis in the liver tissue. In gluconeogenesis, glucose is produced from pyruvate. Initially, liver uses its own pyruvate reserves, but the level of pyruvate in the liver tissue has to be maintained. Because if pyruvate is used for glucose production, then something has to provide pyruvate income into the tissue. And one of the biggest pyruvate stores in our body are skeletal muscles. The concept is that during starvation, to maintain glucose production, organism use protein reserves in muscle tissue. Basically, muscle tissue is an assembly of proteins, and proteins consist of amino acids. Amino acids consist of alpha-keto acid, which is basically a carbon skeleton, and amino group. Alpha-keto acids are pyruvate, oxaloacetate, and alpha-ketoglutarate. They are very useful molecules. So, in muscle tissue, we have three alpha-keto acids. It's pyruvate, oxaloacetate, and alpha-ketoglutarate. Oxaloacetate and alpha-ketoglutarate are the intermediate metabolites of the Krebs cycle. And in the Krebs cycle, alpha-ketoglutarate can be converted into oxaloacetate. And oxaloacetate can be converted through the phosphoenol pyruvate into pyruvate. So basically, as we see, all roads lead to pyruvate. Also, we see that degradation of amino acid results not only in formation of alpha-keto acid, but also in formation of free ammonia. Free ammonia molecules are highly toxic, and they have to be detoxified. And muscle tissue do not have any enzymes to detoxify ammonia. But the organ that can detoxify ammonia is liver. And also we have to know that muscle tissue cannot maintain glucose level in the blood. Because recall that gluconeogenesis results in formation of glucose-6-phosphate, and glucose with phosphate group cannot leave the cell. And the only enzyme that can cleave this phosphate group called glucose-6-phosphatase. And the problem is that muscle tissue do not have glucose-6-phosphatase. So even if muscle cell produced from pyruvate glucose-6-phosphate, it simply cannot be released into the circulation. And there are only two tissues in our body that have this enzyme. It's liver tissue and kidney tissue. So to produce free glucose, pyruvate have to be transported into one of these tissues. So we see that there are two problems. It's free ammonia that have to be transported to the liver and pyruvate that have to be transported to the liver or to the kidneys. And there is a very simple solution. Muscle tissue by the enzyme alanine aminotransferase basically binds free ammonia to pyruvate with formation of alanine. And alanine can enter into the bloodstream. From the bloodstream, alanine is uptaken by the liver tissue. Then liver uptake alanine from the circulation, and by the alanine aminotransferase, liver converts alanine back to pyruvate with release of free ammonia. From pyruvate, liver tissue produces glucose that enters into the blood, and by this liver maintains blood glucose level during starvation. And free ammonia is utilized in the urea cycle with formation of urea molecule that can safely enter into the bloodstream, and from the blood urea is excreted into the urine. So this breakdown of muscle mass with formation of pyruvate and then transportation of pyruvate in form of alanine into the liver tissue with subsequent glucose production and urea formation called Cahill cycle. And there are a few crucial concepts. The specific feature of alanine is that it's neutrally charged amino acid. And because alanine basically do not have charge, alanine do not affect blood pH, thereby it's a safe ammonia transporter. Now, how alanine aminotransferase works? To explain this, we have to know that because ammonia is highly toxic, it cannot remain in muscle tissue in free form. Ammonia have to be always binded to another substrate. So initially we have amino acid, and amino acid have this amino group. Conversion into alpha-keto acid occurs just in one step. Basically, amino acid gives away amino group to alpha-ketoglutarate, in reactions that is catalyzed by the enzymes aminotransferases, and the products of this reaction are alpha keto acid and glutamate. So now this amino group on glutamate. Glutamate gives away ammonia to pyruvate in reactions that is catalyzed by muscle alanine aminotransferase. And as we said, pyruvate can be formed from alpha keto acid. Once glutamate gives away ammonia, it gets converted back into alpha ketoglutarate. So now alpha ketoglutarate is recycled back and can be used again as acceptor of ammonia. And when pyruvate takes ammonia, pyruvate becomes alanine. And alanine enters into the bloodstream and comes into the liver tissue. The logic why alanine is a final acceptor of ammonia is that alanine do not have charge, and because of that, alanine do not affect blood pH. In contrast to alanine, free ammonia molecules will increase blood pH, and glutamate, also called glutamic acid, has negative charge, so glutamic acid will decrease blood pH. So alanine is a safe option to transfer ammonia from muscle tissue through the circulation into the liver tissue. In the liver, alanine transfer amino group to alpha-ketoglutarate. This reaction is catalyzed by the liver alanine aminotransferase. Alanine is converted into pyruvate, and when alpha-ketoglutarate accepts ammonia, it becomes glutamate. And the final point of Cahill cycle in terms of ammonia metabolism is that glutamate is oxidized by glutamate dehydrogenase to alpha-ketoglutarate with release of free ammonia molecule. Ammonia molecules undergo urea cycle with urea formation, and from pyruvate, liver makes free glucose molecules that enter into the circulation, and by this liver maintains glucose level in the blood. So basically it's a general concept of the Cahill cycle.